This episode of the Good Living Now podcast is sponsored by our friends at Kuvings. Now, I've had almost every brand of juicer on the market since I started my healing journey in 2015. But the Kuvings Auto 10 has been a complete game changer. It's easy to use and easy to clean. Plus, I'm able to make smoothies as well as sorbets and plant-based milk. So use my code JUICEGUY and save 10%. All right, you know what to do. Get your juice on. Welcome to the Good Living Now podcast, where we talk to real people about real change leading to real health. I am your host, Harold Leffall. Today, well, we're having a real important conversation that affects so many women. We're talking about fibroids. You know, 20 to 25% of reproductive age women have fibroids. And by age 50, 80% of Black women will have fibroids and 70% of white women will have fibroids. Well, I have an expert here that's going to help us better understand what fibroids are and what women can do to help heal them naturally. Well, she's a certified health coach, and I just learned she's an author. Welcome to the show, Tina Fuller. Hey, hi. Tina. Hey, Arthuris. Come on, Arthur. Look, I just learned you not only have one book, but you got two. I see one of your books back there. That's Womb Strong. We're going to talk about that later. Did you say you have another book? What is it called?
Yes, it's called A Bold Perspective.
We're going to talk about that a little bit. You embody that. You embody a bold perspective. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and how you came about writing that book. But first of all, thank you so much for being a part of the show.
Thank you for having me. I am so honored to be here.
Look, I'm excited to have you because, you know, just talking about and looking at those statistics, it's just kind of mind-boggling, you know, the number of women who are dealing with fibroid issues. And for me, it's very personal to me because my mom had fibroids, ended up having surgery, had a stroke after the surgery, and my mom ended up passing. And she didn't know anything other than what the doctors were telling her. The doctors were telling her, you got to have surgery, you got to have surgery. And what happened is, and I didn't learn this, I think I learned this from you, that many women, after they have a fibroid surgery, they are have an increased risk of stroke. Is that true?
First of all, I'm so sorry that your mom had to endure that and that you even had to endure losing your mom. Now, when it comes down to strokes and how strokes and fibroids can even be related in terms of the conversation, is according to Dr. John Lee, who coined the phrase estrogen dominance, he said the same hormonal imbalances that causes fibroids can also cause strokes and also certain cancers like uterine cancer and breast cancer and so many other diseases.
So let's go back. How did you start doing this work? How did you become a certified health coach, helping hundreds and thousands of women heal their bodies naturally from fibroids? How did you come about doing this work?
It started with my own personal journey, my bold perspective journey. So for me, what A Bold Perspective, the book, is all about, it's about me finally talking about the death of my two-year-old son, who died after he was hit by a car. And for a very long time, I was not willing to talk about it. As a matter of fact, I jumped states. I moved from Ohio to Georgia because I didn't want to be anywhere where anybody else knew about what had happened to me. Okay. And while living my life, you know, wherever you go, there you are. So with me, even though I came 11 hours away, I still brought all of the hurt, the trauma, all of those things, right? And then I got married and I still had not dealt with the hurt, the pain, the trauma. And then there was communication gaps, all that to say that in pursuit of me now trying to get pregnant, because, you know, the next baby gonna help me get over the last baby. Pregnancy was not happening. And so because I was laser focused on anything that felt like it was happening in my stomach, my uterus, my abdomen area, I felt a sensation, a nagging sensation on a scale of 1 to 10. It was like 1.5. Well, I called the gynecologist. And I'm like, okay, something's happening. I need to come in. So I went in, and by the time I got there, I didn't feel the sensation anymore. And my doctor is feeling on my abdomen. She's like, your uterus feels like where it's supposed to be. It feels like the size that it's supposed to be. You don't feel anything. I don't feel anything. You're probably okay. And I was like, but can I get an ultrasound? And she said, yes. And that's when I was diagnosed with 5 fibroids. And the largest one was the size of a plum. And it was sitting at my right ovary, hence the nagging sensation.
Wow. And how old were you at the time?
Let's see. I got married at 30. I got married 1 month prior to my 32nd birthday. So I had to be like right at the cusp of 34 years old.
And so you had 5 fibroids. And what did your doctor recommend you do?
At this stage, I have coached over 150 women as a fibroid coach, and not one other woman has the same story that I have. My doctor, the gynecologist that practiced from a holistic standpoint, said to me, the fact that you have these 5 fibroids lets me know 3 things. Number one, you got a stressful life. You probably got a stressful marriage. I see you married. I'm like, my marriage ain't stressful. I ain't know. You know, I think sometimes when somebody's not knocking you upside the head and the day, all of those things, you don't even consider some of the communication gaps and other things that are happening that's stressful. And it is, right?
Right. So right.
My doctor's like, you probably got a stressful marriage. And I'm like, I don't. And she like, you probably got a stressful job. I'm like, I don't have a stressful job. I'm a hairstylist. I own the salon. Oh my God, that was very stressful. I just thought the hairstylist would get on my nerves. I just thought that stay bored and different things was getting on my nerves, but it was stressful. And then my doctor also said, well, okay, you don't have stress. So maybe you got trauma. You got trauma. And I remember taking a moment because remember, I moved here because I didn't want nobody to know.
Right.
And I paused and I said, well, yeah. I do have trauma. My 2-year-old son was hit and killed by a car some years ago, and I just haven't dealt with that yet because I don't know how to. Now, she was dry as an 8-day-old biscuit because she was like, well, you need to figure out how to deal with that because clearly that's the reason why you got these fibroids. So you need to do what you got to do to figure out how to deal with that. And I remember being like, wow. Of course, that was not an emotional moment. Cause she took away all emotions, any opportunity for she erased it, and so I was like, okay, which was good for me, cause you know I'm on the sensitive side of things. And so I was like, okay, all right. And then the third thing she said to me is, you need to change your diet. The fact that you have 5 fibroids let me know that you too need to change your diet. And then she said, they say, letting me know she didn't really believe it. They say fibroids are also genetic, but that's what they say. So basically, I walked out of there knowing I needed to look at stress that I didn't have.
Right.
That I ain't willing to deal with yet. And then I knew I needed to change my diet. That I was willing to do. I was like, okay, I could do that.
Wow. You know what? And that's probably why Black women have a higher risk of, you know, fibroids, because of the 3 things that you just mentioned that oftentimes get ignored. Just get ignored. And like you said, what's so important, you've coached and counseled 150 people, women who've had fibroids, and none of their doctors had this conversation with them.
Not a one.
So most often when they hear, oh, you have fibroids, the automatic thing is you need to have surgery.
The automatic thing that my clients have said that their doctors have said to them, number one, if they're not bothering you, don't bother them. Number two, you need to get a myomectomy. Number 3, you need to get a hysterectomy.
Now, what's a myomectomy? I've never heard of that.
Myomectomy is another type of surgery where they there's an open myomectomy, then there's a regular myomectomy. Basically, and a lot of them are done with laser today, where basically they just cut out the fibroids and then leave it intact.
Wow. And you know what? So you mentioned some things that I think that we're not paying enough attention to and how it manifests in our bodies, you know, talking about the trauma and the stress, you know, and how that manifests, you know, could manifest in fibroids or some other kind of medical ailment. So what did you start? Okay, so you got that information. What did you do after that once you got that information?
Now, prior to me going to the doctor, because I was trying to get pregnant and I had already started Googling and taking different classes and stuff online to figure out how to conceive naturally. So I had already started making a few changes. At that point, I had already changed. And see, sometimes people think to make changes, you got to change everything about your life. It's like, if I had to, if I waited until I was ready to make all the changes, I would still be the same that I was before. It's like, start with what you can. And the research was showing me that whites was the problem. If it's white, it probably ain't right. So, I was like, let me get rid of this white sugar. Let me get rid of this white salt. So I started there. Okay, so we changed the salt. We're not having white salt no more. Okay, that was easy, right? Then it was like, okay, instead of having sugar, what's the different sweetener that I can have? Let me go for maple syrup. Let me go for date syrup. Let me go for, it was simple things like that. And then I went from there and said, okay, wait a minute. I am eating some form of, now I was addicted to chicken. I was addicted to chicken and dairy.
Me too.
I don't understand why anybody would want to live a life without either one of those. And if you live a life without chicken or cheese, because let me be specific, I can be without ice cream. I didn't have to drink a cup of milk, but I'm going to need some cheese, please, right?
wait, Tina, I was so addicted to both of those. Sometimes I would just give me some chicken and cut it up and mix some cheese in it and just eat the cheese. That's how addicted I was.
I know all about it. And I felt like if you live your life without chicken or cheese, you're not even living a real life. Right?
Look, you ain't living.
I'm the person to live the type of lifestyle that I live today. Well, I looked and said, well, the research is showing that it's not so healthy to eat animal products 3 meals per day. So let me do 2 things. First, let me start buying it organic because, you know, I wasn't ready to let it all go yet. So I was like, let me start buying it organic. And one thing about it, as my daddy would say, one thing about it, when you start buying organic, you decrease your portion. Because buying an organic chicken breast is a very different price than buying a regular chicken breast. And then you realize that the sizes of the chicken is not even the same size. So you look up and now by default, you are not even consuming as much meat as you were before. Or when you might have 4 chicken wings, well, today you got 2 because they cost 4, right?
Right.
And so from there, it turned into the more I ate fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds, ancient grains and legumes, the less my body desired as much meat. So I started saying, okay, I'm just going to have to meet 1 meal per day. And the rest is literally just history. Now, it was strategy involved in the rest, but that's how I started. So in the beginning, I didn't start saying, I'm just going cold turkey and I'm giving up everything. As a matter of fact, vegan, plant-based was not even a goal. I never had a conversation about becoming either or. But the more I ate fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds, ancient grains and legumes, the more my body craved it. And the less I had a palate for eating animal products.
Right. You know, I had the same experience when I went through cancer. I never intended on going plant-based. That was not my goal. I wanted to feel better. And I started eating differently, started eating fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds and stuff like that. And I was like, wait a minute. I feel different. I feel good. It was like, and it was like a feeling I'd never felt before because I had always eaten the way I'd always eaten dairy and meat and all this other stuff. But it wasn't until I started, you know, incorporating more fruits and vegetables because we didn't grow up eating salads or even eating fruits and vegetables. We grew up eating cereals, Kool-Aid, and that kind of stuff. But I started noticing how much better I felt. And I started losing my desire for the unhealthy stuff, you know?
That's how it goes.
Yeah. And I think a lot of times when people, just the thought of it, because I know I was that way, just the thought of eliminating things that you've eaten all your life can seem overwhelming. Like, oh my God, I can't live without it. But like you said, just taking those small steps and incorporating more fruits and vegetables and see how you feel. And it's like I always say, nothing tastes as good as healthy feels.
Say that again.
Nothing, absolutely nothing tastes as good as healthy feels. It just doesn't.
You. I remember, and you got a great point there, because I remember when I first transitioned over to eating more of what I called 80-20 at that time, an 80-20 dietary lifestyle, where I was like 80% eating fruits and vegetables, nuts, seeds, ancient grains, and legumes. And then 20%, I was still allowing myself to have, I stopped eating pork as a teenager. Okay, so I wasn't eating pork. I wasn't eating beef either. So for me, it was more like chicken, turkey, and cheese. And then fish. Certain fish. You had what I call non-scavenger. So it was like the more I ate like that, the better I felt. And I remember being on an interview not too long ago with somebody else on their podcast. And so they asked me, like, so when you turned vegan or plant-based, tell me what that felt like. Was that the best you ever felt in your life? And I was like, honestly, no. The best I ever felt in my life is when I went 80-20. I felt alive in a way that I had never felt before. And I think what happened, I think had I gone from living a standard diet and then went straight to vegan, I would have still had that feeling. But that initial feeling, like that initial high, like the way people talk about runner's high, that life high, was it that because it was like now for the first time, my body was now finally consuming fruits and vegetables without all the chemicals. Because before, I was into conventional vegetables and fruits. I remember my local farmer's market, sometimes in the summertime, they have strawberries and it's like the pack is like 99 cents per bag. I don't know if it's still 99 cents now because that was some years ago, right? We've had all kind of inflation since then. But I remember I was going there and I would buy 5-6 packs. You come pay me to buy a pack of conventional strawberries today. I'm looking for the organic ones, or I'm looking to grow them, right?
But
at that time, it was like the first time my body was getting fruits and vegetables without all the sprays, without all the pesticides. It was the first time that I was consuming less animal products, because remember, I was eating meat or cheese 3 meals per day. And so now here I was, 1 meal a day, but then I transitioned to 1 meal a day every other day. So that's the point where in my 80-20, where I would go a whole day with no animal products. And then the next day, I would allow one of my meals to have animal products. And then the next day, no animal products. Oh my goodness. The high The words that I said to my husband is, for the first time in my life, I believe I feel like what a woman is supposed to feel like.
Wow.
And when you are just used to just how your everyday feel is, you don't even realize that how you are feeling, that you could feel better.
Right.
Especially when you don't feel bad. When you don't feel bad and this is just your everyday, you don't realize that you could feel better. Until you do.
So Tina, so when did the fibroids begin to shrink, or what happened with that process?
So initially, I've had 3 different rounds of fibroids. And at this stage, of course, I coach my clients into not having to repeat like I have, right? So because I didn't, my doctor, first of all, didn't tell me I can shrink fibroids. What my doctor said to me, because I was trying to get pregnant, what she said to me is, you got these fibroids and this is why you need to make these changes. So when I walked out of that office, I knew I needed to make changes. Now, what did I think I was making the changes for? Probably so they wouldn't get bigger. Probably so I wouldn't end up with a fibroid surgery like my mom had had. Like the way some of my aunts had had, right? And so here I am making the nutritional changes, and I didn't want to make the emotional changes, but I had to do those too. We could talk about that later if you want to. Well, 9 months later, I went back to the doctor, and the fibroid that was the size of a plum 9 months earlier was now the size of a cherry.
Wow.
It was gone. And then the beans. I had no idea that I could shrink them. She just told me I need to make changes. But
that was in 9 months. In 9 months. Wow.
And then I went on a course to eliminate those. And then a year and a half later, I didn't even know I had another fibroid until it came out vaginally in my sleep.
Oh.
Right? That's how I when I was. still remember it. It was very vivid. Trust me, it was very vivid because it made a mess. So I, again, didn't even know that I had the fibroid, but I was on day 27 of a 28-day intense detox because here I am still trying to get pregnant. My issue right now is all things. We need to get this baby. Mm-hmm. And so whatever, any and everything that I was reading that was looking like saying, showing potential that it can help me to heal whatever was going on, because clearly it's not the fibroids, because when I didn't have fibroids, I wasn't getting pregnant. Eliminate mm-hmm. the fibroids, still wasn't getting pregnant. So here I am on a journey, still at my about somewhere between 80-20 to 90-10 mm-hmm. with my dietary lifestyle. And I have another fibroid that I don't know until I woke up. Mm. And I remember waking up that morning. I'm a bonus mom. Mm-hmm. And my husband was already awake. It had to be like maybe 6 something in the morning. And the bathroom light is on in our bedroom. Bathroom light mm-hmm. is on. And so I can see the light is on. I know he's up. And I had to pee. So I mm-hmm. go pull back the blanket so I can go and pee. Mm-hmm. And when I felt cold, I was like, what mm-hmm. is going on? And when I went to sit up and I seen my husband about to come back out the bathroom, I put the blanket back on me. I was like, I don't know what just happened, but I'm going to have to wait until he leaves out this door with these kids so I can see what just happened.
Right.
He ended up leaving. And when I got up, my bed looked like a crime scene.
Mm.
And when I got to the bathroom, I had on pajamas. We all grown. Okay. Mm-hmm. I had on pajamas and I had on underwear. And when I put down the pajama layer, when I put down the pajamas, there was layers. It looked like somebody took chitlins and painted them.
Wow.
Red. And when I put down my underwear, I mean, I was startled. I was like, what?
I'm sure you must have freaked out. I'm sure.
I did. I called my my number one confidant. I called my cousin. She like, you need to go to the hospital. What ended up happening is the fibroid imploded itself and released itself vaginally in my sleep. So the first time, I never seen the fibroids come out. I guess they just evolved and came out in urination and my feces.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's how they came out because I never seen them. But the second time, baby, it showed up.
Wow. And
it showed me in all of its glory what it was able. It showed me what the body can do. That's what it did. It showed me what the body can do. And so, of course, I got an ultrasound at that point, and no fibroids was in my uterus. And I was just like, okay. I really understood the power of the body. At that point, I had a mentor, and she passed away in her 90s a few years ago. But she was so feisty. She was so phenomenal. And she would say things like, Tina, the body don't need to know the name of the problem. It just needs to know the solution. I didn't know I had a fibroid, so I didn't know the problem that I was targeting. But I was giving my body the necessary solutions.
Wow.
You know, and the body used what I gave it, and guess what it did? Eliminated more waste.
And that was during, you were on a 21-day?
28-day, and that was day 27.
Wow. And so now that all of them are gone at that point?
Yes.
Wow.
But remember, it's 3 rounds.
Okay. So did something. Now, because we had talked about the fact that one of the things that fibroids are associated with is trauma and stress, unhealed. So, and you have been doing all this physical stuff, changing your diet and all the other stuff, but you hadn't dealt with the stress and the trauma, right?
Actually, I had dealt with the stress and the trauma the first time. And I believe that's the reason why I was able to eliminate the fibroids the first time. Finally started dealing with the trauma. What happened is I wasn't ready to deal with the trauma. And I was so hurt about infertility. It shook me. It rocked me. It shocked me. It made me feel like God forgot about me, because God, how is it that I have lost my son? And how is it that now here I am married and trying to get pregnant and there's no pregnancy? The infertility was so shameful. Man, I had so much shame and hurt centered around it. And I remember one day sitting on the edge of my bed and I had just woke up and I said to myself, if tomorrow happens and nothing is different, it's going to be day one of a grave depression. I'm so visual. I literally saw myself waking up the next day, going to pull back the blanket like you do when you wake up, you get out of bed. And I saw myself pull it back on myself. And I saw myself not getting up. Like, that's it. I've had enough. It has been over a decade of motherhood blues from the death of my son. And then now here's this marriage and I'm this wife and I can't even produce children. Like, what am I doing? You know, I'm in his way. I'm in my way. I don't want to talk about it. Don't nobody really know. My family didn't know. Nobody knew. And I'm grateful that no one, I only had one person, one cousin that kept saying, when are you going to have a baby? Nobody was asking. I think everyone just understood. She's had a child before. She lost a child. If she's not having one, clearly she has decided not to.
Right.
No one was asking. Well, I'm sitting on the edge of my bed and I was just like, this is it. This is it. Because I knew tomorrow I wasn't going to be pregnant. If I was, how would I know? Well, as I was sitting there, my phone rang and I'm in full on tears. And I look down at the phone and it's my aunt. And normally I would not answer the phone, but something said, fix yourself and answer the phone. Answer the phone. And my auntie said, my auntie Loretta, she said, Tina, she said, I know you know you don't know this lady, but I do. And she just called me and said that God has a word for you. And she needed to call her. And I'm like, what? And so I didn't want to call the lady, but my aunt a little bossy. And I knew she would have been calling me back saying, did you call her? You need to call her. And so I gathered myself. And the whole time I was fussing. I said, this don't make no sense. I'm not in the mood. I'm supposed to call some lady that don't know me and I don't know her and call her on her cell phone in a nursing home. All of it was so dumb to me. But out of obedience, I called. And as soon as that lady answered the phone, she said, baby, God said he has not forgotten about you. He is going to restore you, but first you must share your story. Well, at this point, here's all of the trauma with the death of my son that I have never unboxed. I don't talk about it. People where I live don't know about it. My husband knows about it, but I'm like a ticking bomb. I'm literally walking around as an emotional ticking bomb. And I was so angry that instead of God giving me the baby that I'm asking for, you come with a request talking about I need to share something that I have moved away 11 hours away, thousands of miles. I don't want to talk about that. And now here's infertility. I certainly don't want to talk about that. I cried so hard on the phone with that lady that she put her prayer partner, her roommate in the nursing home on the phone to pray too. So they was praying for me. Eventually I got off and I just laid out on my bed and I sobbed. And the next day I got up and I started thinking. I went back to my earliest memories and I came up as far as I can remember. And at that point, that was probably up until about 16. And then the next day I picked back up 16 and pregnant, 17 on a table delivering a baby. 18 years old, still graduating, 19 years old, going off to college with this baby, 19 years old, my son got hit and killed by a car. Then I went all the way up until that very moment of where life was. The next day, I got a pen and started writing. And then I looked up some books later and published the book of Bold Perspective. So I had dealt with it. I finally let it out, right? Which is why I was able to eliminate the fibroid. The second one, it was probably more diet and definitely some stressful things that I wasn't really dealing with appropriately on stress because I had not figured out how to say what I mean without saying it, right? I was not exercising self-expression. Lack of self-expression is also what caused the fibroids. Okay? And I wasn't exercising self-expression in areas where I needed to. And then, why did I get fibroids the third time? Several things. I transitioned to a vegan dietary lifestyle the wrong way.
Talk about that.
I did what a lot of people do. When we go from eating animal products, we jump over and start eating a bunch of starch. We eating the French fries and we eating all of the rice and all the carbs and all the things. That is a recipe for glucose spikes.
Right.
Causing insulin resistance,
weight gain.
Weight gain. Which I didn't gain the weight. I stayed lean. But I gained a 13 centimeter fibroid, which is the size of a sweet potato. And so it wasn't, at that point, it wasn't just the diet. There was two other factors. It was still me not expressing myself. It was still me, even in my marriage, having things that were so frustrating to me, but I'm not really talking about it. It's just like me holding it. It's me trying to be non-confrontational. It's me trying to be the perfect wife, and I'm feeling like I need to make sure that I'm kind of walking on eggshells, because you're already not producing the baby, so you might as well be around this joint, right?
Right, so right. That,
and then something else happened. Something else happened that I didn't consider. I didn't know, not even though I have been teaching the work of fibroids for 4 years now, and I have been on a fibroid healing journey for 8 years now. This third round of fibroids makes 8 years for me. Now, this last time, the third thing that was happening is issues with my lungs, with my respiratory system. Issues with a bunch of toxins and chemicals that I was bringing in. I was a hairstylist for 23 years and 8 months, and don't leave off my 8 months, because it was, those were eight more months of breathing in chemicals. And this stuff get jammed up in your lungs. And your lungs is a part of your detoxification system. And anywhere you have congestion and blockages inside of your detoxification system, it's more of a recipe for fibroids too. So it's almost like, and you know, it's it becomes disheartening, if I'm being transparent, when you have eliminated fibroids one time and two times, and then you're stuck in a fibroid a third time, and the same work that you have done before that you're teaching your clients, you're watching them heal. You're watching them become fibroid free, and you're stuck, and you're like, well, what's the problem? Well, I still had to learn more. I feel like that God has chosen me and allowed me to have to go through almost every single reason. And I, at this point, know of about 10 reasons in my book, I outline them, of why you could have fibroids. And I think God allowed me to do that, because if I'm only teaching from the perspective of stress, trauma, diet, and if a person get all of those together like the way I had, and they still have a fibroid and they cannot figure out why, well, then what else? Well, I have reached my capacity of being able to help them. But if I have to go through all these different channels to find out all these different reasons, I solve mysteries, not just for myself, but for women in general. Because like you mentioned earlier, up to 80% of women will have fibroids. And just in case you think that, well, it's just something with Black women, 70% of white women have them. If we just think, well, women up by the age of 50, they're going to have them. Well, 25% of women in between 15 to 25 have them. So it's something that we all need to be paying attention to. And just in case we think this conversation is just centered around women who are premenopausal, I have coached with women in their 60s who have already hit menopause and beyond it, and they still have fibroids trying to figure out how to get rid of them. So it's the conversation that is women, we all need to be paying attention to.
Yeah, that is so true. And you know, and it's so important for us just to realize that any kind of dis-ease in the body, any kind of ailment in the body, there's often a mind-body-spirit connection. It's those three things. It's not typically just one. And what I've learned is that pain is information. It's information. It's our body giving us feedback, but so often we ignore it. We ignore the feedback that our body is telling us. This fibroid, you know, just not about, you know, what you're eating, the other things going on. Just like for me, my cancer wasn't just about what I was eating. It was about my unhealed trauma and the way I had normalized being stressed out all the time. Not even realize I was stressed because it was so normal. And when we're stressed out all the time like that, it weakens our immune system. It makes us susceptible to anything, you know, any kind of ailment. And I don't think in our community, we talk enough about the stuff that ails us, that causes us to have, you know, diseases and dealing with health struggles because we don't tell the truth about what we're going through, you know.
Absolutely. And we haven't had the privilege to do that because about it, especially in this country, when we think about our ancestors, look at what they were up against and guess what they had to carry on. Because if they didn't, their lives would be lost literally from multiple reasons. Right.
Yeah.
And so we have been passed down this ideology of just carry on because that's what we do. When a lot of other nationalities have been able to slow down, go get therapy, slow down, take off of work, slow down, go on vacation.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, you just made me think about something. I was thinking about my mom. I remember when my mom's mom, my grandmother, when she passed, my mom, like right after my grandmother, we had her funeral. My mom just got back up and went back to work. And I mean, there was no break. There was, you know, there was no conversations about, you know, grandma not being here, how you feel. There was nothing. My mom just got back up and just got back in her routine. And I did the same thing when my mom died. So I'm a single dad. So when my mom died, I just got back up and I did what I saw my mother doing. Just got back up, take my son to school. There was this void, there was this emptiness, but I didn't know how to talk about what I was feeling. I didn't even know how to grieve. I didn't even know how to, you know, because as a Black man, it seemed weak to talk about my feelings and, you know, and my fears and like, and my anger, because like you, I was mad at God. How are you just going to take my mom off? You know, and I carried that around for about 10 years. And, you know, I believe that my diagnosis was a culmination of things, but that was definitely a part of it. And I think, you know, my healing came about, you know, I'm just changing my diet. But when I got into therapy and started talking about what I had experienced, and realized that I was setting up a pattern for my son to do the exact same thing. Ooh. And my therapist really helped me to see some gaps in my own parenting and what I wasn't giving my son. Mm. Like my therapist, she kind of made me mad. And if your therapist don't make you mad, you ain't got the right therapist. She made me mad because I was complaining about my son was acting up at school, you know, and I was, you know, complaining about that and just frustrated. And one of the things that, and so she wanted to talk to my son. So she talked to my son. And one of the things that my son told her was that my dad never tells me he loves me. Mm. When I tell you that, almost, it did bring tears to my eyes because it was the truth that I didn't want to hear, but it was how I was raised. My parents never told me that they loved me. I just assumed, I mean, it was just like assume, but it was something I always wanted to hear. And here I am doing the exact same thing to my son, not telling him that I love him. You know, we think in our communities, if you providing food and all this other stuff, you checking homework, that's love. No, they need to hear it. You need to hear it. You know, you need to hear that. And it really helped me just to resolve some things, even with my parents, even though that they weren't there, that I had some resentment toward them because they, you know, they didn't give me what I felt I needed as a kid. And so I'm carrying around these wounds and some resentment because they didn't give me what I wanted, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think in our community, we really need to consider, we all have trauma. And talking to your cousin and boo-boo them, that oftentimes is not enough because oftentimes we're at the same level. We need someone that has some different information, some different tools, some different resources to help us unpack all this stuff that is weighing us down and showing up as disease, showing up as lack, showing up as self-sabotage in our life.
I completely agree with that. And I feel like you, when my son died, like think about this. One day I was an everyday teenager. Mm-hmm. I was in, let's see, I walked into 11th grade pregnant.
Mm. Okay.
So one day I was an everyday teenager, just finished 10th grade, cheerleading, track, regular school, friends, hanging out, just life. And then 16 years old and pregnant. Right? 17 years old on a table with a whole kid, an entire kid. My life changed so fast. I was like, what am I about to do? Right? And it just so happens, I'm so grateful for my school, Cleveland Heights High. My school offered vocational programs. And so I took cosmetology while in high school. And you had to have enough credit hours. So I spent 70% of my day in cosmetology school. And then the 30% of the school in regular high school. And so here I am. By the time I graduate high school at 18 years old with a one-year-old, I also have all of my hours for my cosmetology license. All I got to do is go take my test, right? Go take my test, get my cosmetology license. I enroll in college. I finish my freshman year of college. The summer going into sophomore year, my two-year-old son got hit and killed by a car. I didn't know how to deal with that. I was still a teenager. So in 3 years, I went from being a teenager to an entire parent with daycare, with responsibilities for buying him clothes and Pampers and a breastfeeding mom in school, all the things, right? I ain't even gonna lie. I was the teenage mom on welfare. I live with my parents, but I have food stamps. I remember being so embarrassed that I would go with them packs. You know, the little packs, pull out the little the numbers, you know, the little dollars and food stamps. I had them. You know, I remember having to go to the WIC office. Like, it was so much. It was so much involved in that. But I was so in love with my son and in a healthy way. Let me say that. Right. I was so in love. I love this kid. Like the way any mom should love her child, right? And to go and now to lose a child, I didn't know how to deal with that. I was still trying to learn how to be a teenager. I was still trying to deal with just life and figure out emotions and living and just being. And now here I was with a son that was deceased. I was so afraid. I remember the fear. I had more fear than anything after he died because I did not want to destroy my life. I don't want to compare pains. I have just recently lost my dad and one of my close friends of 30 years. Thank you. In this last year, the pain of their death has no comparisons to the pain of my son's death. It's night and day. And any person, any mom I have ever talked to who have lost a child like me, there are no words. I was so afraid, Harold. And I was so afraid that I was going to destroy my life. That I was like, what I have to do is just carry on. And what I did is I went enrolled in the next semester of school and I got 21 credit hours. 21. I was working at the salon and I went and got a part-time job and a boyfriend. Because I tried to make sure that there was no idle time to think about what had happened and what was going on, because the pain was so intense. It was so intense. And you're right. We have to slow down and figure out. First of all, we gotta slow down to know that you feel how you feel.
Right.
And the pain doesn't go away. Right. And if you just try to mask it with things like drugs and alcohol, which I didn't touch either or, because I knew if something gave me relief for 30 minutes, it would become an addiction. And I could not afford it because I didn't want to waste my life.
Right.
So what I did was just like, we're just moving forward. We're not dealing with this because we can't. And boy, did I lose a lot of time on my book, A Bold Perspective. It has the name, and then it has a road, and then it has a sign, and it says 16 miles. The 16 miles actually represents the years. After my son died, after his funeral, it was 16 years before my parents even heard me mention my son's name. Because it became a rule. Nobody mentioned his name to me, take down his pictures. We have to act like none of this happened. When my parents heard me mention my son's name, it was in my book. That was insane.
Wow.
It was insane. Now, for me, it was, we're just not going to talk about it. But for somebody else, it's drugs. For somebody else that's like me, it's food. It's retail therapy. But none of that helps because it's all idle. It's delusional. Right? It's only for the moment. And we have to get into getting real help, like you said. Well, my dad died December 15th of 2023. And then my girlfriend died January 10th. Think about the time frame. It was 25 days. I said, that's it. I'm getting therapy. I was literally in the midst of fertility. I had to stop the fertility stuff and go get therapy. And I stayed in therapy for 4 months. Every other week, I was in therapy because I know what grief did to me before. So I agree with you. It's okay to get the help that you need. It's okay to cry. It's okay to scream. It's okay to be mad. It's okay to really find out how you really feel instead of trying to create an illusion of how you feel. But you feel how you feel. Right? And tears are so good. I feel so good since I have released that. So thank you for allowing this moment to be.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that. Thank you so much for sharing that.
You're welcome. This is how we help each other.
Right. And you know, everything that we go through, it's not just about us. It's so that we can help other people, you know.
Hello.
And sometimes, you know, we go through some hard things and some hard lessons, but it's not for naught, you know. And it helps us be able to be sensitive and vulnerable and help us to be able to talk to people from a real place. I've been there. I ain't just telling you something I done read in a book, you know. I didn't walk this thing out. And I'm living this thing out, you know. So thank you for sharing that. And thank you so much for the work you're doing. And look, I can just talk to you all day. I can look, but I know there are going to be so many women that are going to want to talk to you and find out more specific things of what they can do to help heal their bodies naturally from fibroids. And I want you to tell us how we can get in contact with you. But before we go get to that, tell us a little bit about Womb Strong, that book you got behind you before.
Womb Strong is such a labor of, it's a labor of life. This is my legacy, right? I believe that all of what I have gone through with fibroids and having to learn so many different dynamics of them was all for the moment of being able to create this book. Now, a way that women can find me, you can find me mostly on Instagram. You can find me as Tina Marie Fuller, also Fuller Quest, FullerQuest. Now, what I just did, I have spent the last 48 hours, the last 2 days, working on something that I think would be so incredible for women, and it's free. I think a lot of times we don't know where to start when it comes down to fibroids. We don't know what the signs are, what the symptoms are. And then once we find out we have them, we don't know what to do. I just created what's called the Womb Strong Fibroid Audit. So I just created an audit for you. And the audit is designed to tell you what the signs are, what the symptoms are, what the causes are for fibroids. And I even walk you through some of the stages of how you can go about changing your lifestyle so that way you can heal naturally. And you can find that at TinaMarieFuller.com. And again, it's free. And then after you get finished with that audit, you can get the book. Because the book is going to take you through. Not only does this book walk you through the information in this book, but do you see this number here?
I see that number.
What does it say?
Is that a 60?
It says 60. That's how many recipes are in this book.
Oh, come on now.
Make it just the informational, even though it's informational, it tells you different strategies on how to heal your, how to heal fibroids because they don't belong to you. I don't want to hear you say my fibroids and I almost said how to heal your, they don't belong to you. They don't belong to me. They are the fibroids. So there's so many tips and strategies, principles my clients are using the information in this book along with herbs, Womb Strong Herbs, to heal the 30-day womb care kit. The womb care kit is going to help you with the information in this book. But start with the audit. Get yourself the audit so that way you can, it's questions for you to help you even see your own life, to help you figure out why you even have fibroids. So start with the audit.
Oh, I created that
because I would be on here with you. I was like, you know what?
Come on now. That's awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. I'm sure so many people are going to take advantage and find great benefit in that. That is awesome. Thank you for that.
Come on, womb.
So the books are Womb Strong, and the first one is Bold Perspective.
Yes.
And where can people can find them on your website?
You can definitely find Womb Strong on my website, but just in case it's sold out, because sometimes it'd be sold out. If you get it from me, I'll autograph it.
Come on, because wasn't it a number one Amazon bestseller?
Yes, in 7 categories. Hello.
Come on now.
I have to drop this and say, what you are going to pay for in this book, I have spent about $20,000 gathering the information that you're going to get in this book that ain't even going to cost you $100. And I have spent at least $20,000.
Come on now.
Get the information for this book, okay? Mm. And just in case it's sold out on my website, it's on Amazon. On Amazon, it ain't going to be signed. But if you get it from me, I actually sign it. Same thing with Bold Perspective. If you do not see a Bold Perspective on my website, you can get it on Amazon. Now, when it comes down to the herbal products, they not on Amazon. Can I show you what some of my customers I have a 4-part herbal kit. At the time of this video, I have I'm trying to move out of the country at some point. I ain't gonna be shipping internationally.
Right.
Okay. So this is the kit that my customers and clients have been using to help them to eliminate weight, balance hormones, so that way they can get fibroid free. And let me say this too, because a lot of times women feel the pressure to run and get surgery because they feel like my period is 10 days long, it's 11 days long, and I need to get out of this heavy period, or I'm having cramps on a scale of 1 to 10, baby it's a 9, and I can't wait for the fibroids to be gone, I need relief now. Within 30 to 60 days, 90% of my clients, even with fibroids, get out of heavy periods and pain.
Wow.
Say that again, but the other way. 90% of my clients within the first 30 to 60 days get out of heavy, painful periods and they go on to live in peaceful periods.
Wow.
Then they eliminate the factors, not that just cause fibroids, but that's causing you to be inflamed, that's causing you to have heavier periods. There's reasons for that. I have had fibroids 3 different times. I've never had a period longer than 5 days. And on average, it's 3 days. I have not experienced painful cramps.
Right?
Not a period cramp. I have not, but it has everything to do with my lifestyle. So when my clients get this book and follow the principles in this book, they get out of pain and heavy periods. And then let me show you the 4-part series and what it does. So this right here is Nurture Tea. You drink this while you are on your period. Wait a minute, I grabbed one. Oh, it is over here. So this is Nurture Tea. You drink this while you're on your period. Then there is Purge Tea. Purge Tea is going to help flush out your liver. Harold, you know how important it is to get your liver together, right?
That's right, yeah.
This is going to get the waste out of your body. So you drink this when you are not on your period. So this is your period tea. This is your non-period tea. And then there is Smoothie Powder, which smoothie powder is good for helping to relax you. It's good for calming. It has medicinal mushrooms in there, which also helps to shrink fibroids. And then I also have Golden Infusion. Golden Infusion is puts inflammation in check. My customers and clients who are having heavy and painful periods, far too often they got too much inflammation inside of their body. Only drink 3 tablespoons of this per day. It's simple. So let me say that again. You drink 3 tablespoons of this per day. 1 teaspoon of this, you can put it in a smoothie. If you don't want to put it in a smoothie, I got clients that put it in their mouth and swallow it down with water. Is that simple? And then once a day, you're drinking a cup of tea. If you're on your period, you drink Nurture. If you're not on your period, you drink Purge. That simple. It's simple.
Well, and where can they get the supplements from? Is it on your website?
It is. It's at TinaMarieFuller.com. And just in case you can't remember my whole name, think of Womb Strong. Both of them go to my website. If you put in WombStrong.com, it's going to go here. If you put in Tina Marie Fuller, it's going to get you here. Okay? Both places are going to get you to the same place.
Wow. Wow. You know what, Tina? You know, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your courage, your resiliency, and your willingness to share and help other women live better, feel better. I really, really appreciate all you're doing. Thank you so much.
And I feel the same way about you. You have taken IG by storm. And it's because of those exact same reasons, because you have been very transparent about your journey. And you constantly, for $3.99, show people what to do. It's one thing to know how to do it and you're doing it yourself, but it's a whole nother thing to now turn around and show us and to show women and men how they can improve their lifestyle. So you are so appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, I'm so, look, we're going to have you back. We're going to have you back for sure.
I would love to come back.
All right.